right away. Oh, good. These are Siamese twin chairs.
Fine. You guys are great. I love you guys so much.
Hi, everybody.
Hi.
Hey, what's happening? Anyway? This is a are we supposed to ask you guys questions? Yeah. I have a question for you. Where'd you get that Disneyland shirt?
Oh.
It's gonna be a long day. Although, well, that's right, you guys are supposed to ask. Right. Should we tell them what we did and how we got here?
Yeah, would you like to just hear it quick how we got into this?
Yeah, let's do it. Woo. Right.
Go ahead.
Okay, now first I have to remember, let's see, well, I started acting when I was 10 years old, and I did theater. And yay, theater!
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Oh. I did a lot of musical theater and grew up, went to North Carolina School of the Arts, moved to Chicago, did more theater, moved to New York, did Broadway, and I always kind of wanted to do voiceover, but I was never in the right city. It was Chicago does ads, and New York does a little animation, but not that much. And so I moved to LA, got my chance, and started auditioning. And I think my first animation job was I did the leads in the MGM movies.
Oh, nice.
Thanks to Maria Estrada, awesome woman that she is. And so I did Jenny McBride in The Secret of Nim.
Nice.
Thatcher and Tom Sawyer, and then finally, I was auditioning so much and not getting anything that I had this audition at Nickelodeon for a show called Chalk Zone.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I'm not gonna get it anyway, so let's just be as weird as we can. So I went in and was like, well, yes, Rudy, that's an excellent And then that worked. And thankfully, I've been doing
same thing. I did the exact same thing. Oh, no, wait. No, I was born in Amsterdam. But yeah, I was always the obnoxious kid getting kicked out of class, you know. Excuse me. But the joke's on Sister Mary Agnes now. I turned monkey hour into a career. And, you know, I was always in plays, and I was always in bands and singing and playing drums, and I always did it. When I was a little kid, I'd see Paul Winchell or Mel Blanc or Paul Frees, all these guys that would, you know, they're making a decent living doing stuff that got me in trouble. So I thought, well, I'll do that way. And I made a demo tape in 84 when I was 12. And I snuck into I didn't know it was impossible to break into because I was hidden, and so I accidentally did, and then I lucked into the first job that I auditioned for. Thank you, Lord. And now I get to hang out with you guys all this time later. So yeah, that was that. That's how that went. Hi, here we are. Hey, nice place you guys have here.
Oh, thanks. Hey. Sacramento loves you guys.
If you love pink hair, you're in the right seat. I walk around and I'm getting hungry for cotton candy. And I can't quite put my finger on it.
What about snow cones?
So, yeah, I'm pretty sure. Oh, now, so are you guys, you have to come up and talk to the mic?
I guess so.
Okay, you are all going to get to be a little... get to do some voiceover here today.
Oh,
no. They're gonna wrestle.
Oh, yeah. Do you mind holding this one?
Yeah, just where's the line start?
We have a moderator or
okay.
But apparently we don't, right?
Thank you.
There it is.
I think so too. So yeah, come on down. I bet you're the first one. See, I'm psyched.
Thank you so much for doing this.
Yes, Mr. Cummings, I am so happy you're here, and I have a question I would like to ask you. I was wondering, in your intimidating Dr. Robotnik voice, can you say, "You miserable hedgehog, I will crush you"? between the Derby videos. You did that really well. I love your intimidating voice a lot in ways you can't imagine, but not in that way. Maybe I don't want to imagine.
Okay,
so I'm not sure what you said, but are you a friend of Snivelly's? I knew it. Am that hedgehog? I hate Snivelly, but I hate that miserable hedgehog from the bottom of my cold metallic heart.
Wow, dude, I don't even touch that. That wasn't even a question, but it was a great answer.
But you're the reason I'm telling you. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, man. Good job. Dr. Robotnik, ladies and gentlemen.
Hey there, guys. Big fan of voice actors, big respect for what you've done. Jim in particular, I grew up hearing your voice a lot.
That's because I'm old, man.
My question for you is, this isn't, like, necessarily your favorite episode you've done, though it very well could be.
Well,
do you remember
like
a script that just like blew your mind or you thought was very smart for some reason, either because you know it was very witty humor, you know, handled the subject material very well, you felt just something where when you finished reading it, you were just like, I can't wait to do this episode.
You mean like the Bible or something? No, I don't know. what show was it?
Any show.
Oh, geez, I don't know. I sure liked a lot of the Darkwing scripts. That were some really good writing out there. Gosh, there's so many of them. I probably did too many to nail one down, but I like the writing on Henry Gilroy does on Star Wars Rebels. I think I want to say, you guys do Hondo.
Yes.
Noggin's coming back.
Yeah.
You got to watch, man. George Lucas and those guys, you're not allowed to talk to... I'm sorry, George, I didn't say anything. He's got drones, and you can't say anything before you're allowed to. So, but I think I was in the thing, so... But that's great, incredible writing. It's really good, it's really nuanced, and then, I don't know, man, so many of them. You know, a lot of the blue things were so heartfelt, you know, and it's so... So sweet that just kind of tugged at your heartstrings. You know, different things. You know, you appreciate different things about different shows. What about you? You know what I mean?
Episode ever of anything?
Not necessarily favorite, but something that you just by reading you felt was like very smart, very well written. Couldn't wait to.
Totally repeat what Jim said. The writers are just killing it. I think animation now is.
Yeah, Teen Titans is killing. You guys are monsters.
Yeah.
In a good way.
Some of those that I read are so funny. And there's a show that's about to come out. We're probably not allowed to talk about, but since it is about to come out, it's called When the Night Begins to Shine, which is they took like a stock catalog song from about 1987 and made it like Cyborg's favorite song. And do we sing every verse of it in the song in the show? Yes. Do we sing every verse of it more than once in the show? Yes. And we listen to it at first, and it's literally like the worst kind of 80s.
My Sharona.
Oh, yeah.
Take bids. What is the name of the song?
When the Night Begins to Shine. And it was
Baby.
From the Warner Brothers catalog, as it was never released. It was just some stock thing.
Oh, wow.
And we started listening
Leave
to it,
the
and
side.
The beat just kept coming. And we're like, now, Scott Mendel and Carrie Payton. Yes.
When we're a little quiet or a little down in the
session,
they'll get out their phones and I'll
hear da na 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 I grew up with you, and I'm like, oh, really good, Michelle. But I was going to ask for both of you guys, what is all these characters you voice over here? There's a lot of cool toys, plushies. Do you guys own any plushies or toys or characters you voice over the years? Or fans have given you any cool stories?
Oh, sure, yeah. Yeah, I always collect if somebody makes a you know, an action figure out of one of my guys. I always have one. But my my ex-wife, and this is why she's my ex-wife, she gave away my first, because I was like one of the first Transformers back in the 80s. And she just found these Ripper Snapper and Afterburner in the garage once, and this little kid next door was like, oh, well, what it loves, Mrs. Cummings. I don't know, here you go. And they go, what do you want? What? And then I found out like a month later, and I went, what? Oh, here, hold this.
Oh.
Yeah. So yeah, I do collect them, except for those two. Yeah. I mean, that's why she's my ex. I'm just kidding. She was evil in other ways. Two.
I got the Pop Dolls finally. I had to buy them, but that's okay.
Yeah. So,
I have my action figures and my Pop Dolls on my desk, but I can't keep them. But they don't really give us stuff anyway.
I have all your Pez dispenser guys.
Yeah, Pez dispensers?
No, I just made that up. But it sounded good. You never know, right? Yeah, there you go.
By the way, Princess
Marvel. But I have one of your toys,
oh,
Captain America.
That's sweet. You're a true American, my sweet. And Dark Window.
Excellent. Thank you, sir. I am the terror that flaps in the night. I am the bug that splatters across the windshield of crime. And Darkwing Duck.
Thank you so much.
Hey, big fan of both of you guys.
Oh, you got
my question is mostly for Jim.
I want to switch.
Last year, we lost a very talented voice actor by the name of Izzy Havilon, who we worked with on Garfing Doug and Sonic Set Am. I'm just wondering, what was she like to work with?
Oops, sorry. I'm so sorry.
What was she like as far as like personality?
She was a doll. She was an absolute doll. You know, she's very, very, very down to earth she's coordinated as she could possibly be.
Do I sit over here then?
She sounded, her own voice was just right next to Gosling's. And of course she was Bay, pig in the city, the pig.
Actually, she was the voice of Bay in the first movie, and the second one in DTK.
That's exactly right. But she was just a great gal. You know, she was, I want to say she's from Utah. She was a small town girl, you know, can't take her, cute as a button, and just, you wanted to hug her, you know?
Aww.
And she was as real as she could be, and just a little angel, and God bless you, darling.
Aww.
Yeah, sweet Gosling, yeah. Yeah, thank you for bringing her up. She's an angel.
You're welcome.
All right. I grew up with Lady LaPoo, and Ray Drew.
I'm sorry. That's good question, too.
I love that show from my childhood, and I was wondering if you could do the rest of the panel with this next week.
Aww.
Well, of course.
Aww.
How's everybody doing? Is this the bouncing one? I love this guy. Watch this. That is a wonderful thing right there, I tell you. The only one, the only one, the only one,
the only one. Oh, man. I'm so glad you're here. Oh, I know. I know.
It's like a bird lark with Rod in there. That was awesome.
Yeah. Well, Paul Winchell, he's a buddy of mine. God bless him. And we talked about it a lot. And because he was going back and forth. Very, 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 very first show, The New Adventures of Winnie the Pooh.
Yes.
He would be taking some time, then he'd go to Africa to cure hunger. I said, no, really. He was an amazing dude. And he'd come back and forth, and we would talk about it. And he said that he put together, like, Bert Lahr, carved in line. And one of the, like, the kid from Brooklyn and sort of a tough street kid with that. And I always thought in my head, do you guys remember the Bowery Boys? It was an old, it was like a 1940s serial. They used to be on TV before there was cable. When I was a little kid, there was a guy in there named Satch. There was Slim Mahoney and Satch and everything. And I thought there was a little Satch in there, but I think it might have been just a draw. I don't know if anybody, yeah, the Bowery Boys and the Dead End Kids. It was one of those old things. Well, he was one of those, you know, I think he looked like Tigger. I don't know, I could be wrong, but he didn't have stripes. But what was the question? I just started turning. She didn't ask anything, did she? Okay. Thank you.
Oh man. Sorry. I watched the original Teen Titans. Someone asked this question very similar to this, but what were both of your favorite, like, do you either of you have a favorite role that I don't know, out of your whole voice acting career?
Oh my gosh, they're all me. They're all me at different times. They all come from me. Generator Rex playing Breach, who was basically Ally Sheedy from The Breakfast Club, except dead. Or Starfire, hello, wonderful friend. It's so nice to make the acquaintance with you.
I love her.
I love her.
I'm a genius.
Yeah, I know. Just ask her.
Yeah, exactly. So they really are all me. I mean, Blackfire, everybody, Princess Bubblegum. How about you?
Yeah, I like yours too. No, I always like. I think Pooh and Tigger are in their own sort of category, you know. And Taz is too, you know. They're like this sort of those classic guys that have breeds, but. I've always liked Darkwing.
Yeah.
Part wise guy, part, and he always gets his comeuppance, and I enjoyed Mr. Bumpy, which was on TV like for like 2 years, I think. Bump in the Night, that was a good one. And I really like Ray from Princess and the Frog.
Yeah.
Because you know, I'm halfway from New Orleans, and my little girl Gracie looked exactly like Princess Tiana at the same time when she was the beginning of the movie, and you know, I just always loved New Orleans music, and I think I like that movie Princess and the Frog too, because it was finally a person from a real town, assuming New Orleans is real.
That's a good Cajun accent too.
Yeah, and it was and Ray, and actually Hondo Ohnaka, I like him a lot.
Yeah. From Star Wars. Yes, he's back.
So yeah, what were your favorite roles?
Oh man,
No, I mean the cake.
The cake is alive.
Not yet.
Yeah.
Thank you so
much
for
being here.
Thank you.
Aww. Oh, hi!
Jim, it's so cool you're here. Thank you for coming and sharing so surreal standing here talking to you guys. I still wake up hearing the Winnie the Pooh theme in my head.
Yeah.
I still expect to hear Pooh and Tigger.
Oh, yeah. Which one? Gotta get up.
Yeah. Gotta go and
go see your friends. Yeah. I never heard that one.
And then Starfire is so
cute.
I know, she's great. We love her.
Yeah.
I have two little girls, Gracie and Lulu, they're 8 and 10. And I just sit there and get in and out all the time. It's a great thing.
You guys done a lot of great characters over the years. I was wondering, like, how do you guys come up with a character? Like, does someone give you picture, directions, or?
Well, when we go into audition, we'll get different things. We'll get a description of the character in words, or we'll just get a picture, or we'll get both, or we'll get neither. And you've just gotta be psychic and come up with, in less than 1 second, whatever your take on that is, and hope it matches what they want. And so, yeah, it comes from all different things, like a character's mouth, I did Penny, but she always had this weird sideways mouth thing going on.
Sometimes I take the whole minute.
But
it's true. You know, sometimes it's fun to see like a big giant guy and give him a little bit of voice. You know, something like, and you know, you just kind of, I think of it as almost sculpting a little bit, audio sculpting, if that makes sense. Because, you know, the producer's going to have an idea, the writer's going to have an idea. We don't listen to them. you know, the voice directors, they all have an idea. And I think, you know, the physicality of it, you know, looking at the character helps. You know, that it's, you know, if you're playing a giant, then he's going to be a little bit bigger. You know, something just depends. But like I say, sometimes it's fun to go against type. Like, I remember, but it was this big, gigantic guy, and I decided that it would be fun to have him sound like Mike Tyson. that voice should be coming out of him, but I ain't going to tell the brother. You sound good to me, man. Yes, sir, Tyson. But it's fun to go against type like that sometimes. And you know, usually, one thing is when you're doing something and you look at the booth and they're going,
"Tuh."
That's a good sign. You know, but if they want, not so good. You know, so you go until you get that first base.
Right.
Because that's the way you do it. I don't know. But thanks, yeah. So, thank you, guys. Yes, sir.
My question is actually directed towards you, Ms. Walsh, and you look very lovely.
Thank you so much.
So I was wondering something. In one of the episodes of Adventure Time, Princess Bubblegum was first introduced, and she comes out of her room, and it looks as if there's like a skeleton behind her.
Wow.
And then in another one, when in the Teen Titans Go, I guess like Robin's looking through Star Wars' room, and he pulls under the sheets and sees a skeleton underneath her bed. And I was wondering, is that the creator's way of saying that the characters you play have a dark side, or you yourself have a dark side?
Oh.
Okay, this is now the topic of your thesis. You have just kind of uncovered a mad conspiracy. The explanation of both of those episodes is outstanding. Being an English major myself, I highly recommend you write at least a 25-page paper. I think you're going to prove it. Was intentional.
Did Master Satan do it?
My question's for Hayden. When I was a kid, I grew up watching Teen Titans, and I absolutely loved it. It was like a huge inspiration in my life, and it's still like one of my favorite cartoons of all time. And I was just wondering, like, how you feel about like the kind of, it's kind of a big change between like the original series and Teen Titans Go now is like very different, like the feel of it and everything like that. I was wondering how you feel about that.
It was the happiest phone call ever to find out we're going back and doing more. We love each other. The Titans really do love each other. And it was a little weird at first. We're kind of like, what is going on here? And then we got to play giant comedy. And I got to see how talented my cast is with handling giant comedy. I mean, Scott.
Well, that music, too. Oh, you guys are crushing it.
Oh, yeah, the singing?
Yeah, oh, yeah, yeah.
Do you know how the singing happens?
Uh-oh.
Oh, I know exactly. They're like, well, we think there should be a song here, so why don't you just make something up right now? It's really, that was impressive. Okay.
Wow.
Yeah, what was John DiMaggio's line? Somebody call Pascal? Yeah. But
yeah.
We love doing the comedy. I love where the show is going. It's like high satire now that is super funny for adults as well as for little kids, and I mean they're just knocking it out of the park. So, and we love doing the show.
It's so great.
So all good all around.
Thank you.
Nice. What's that though? Oh, he's the right dude. Oh, okay.
Hello.
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 Thank you, love.
What are you doing?
So you guys just had your autographs this morning, which is really cool. And so, and my question is, what was the most interesting or weirdest thing you had to sign for a fan? Pretty average stuff, like...
Bresses.
Oh.
What?
chests. But not today, but in the past, yeah. Anybody got any interesting tattoos there? No, that would be it for me. You know, it's really hard to decide, not this little guy so much, but the really plushy ones.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
Like as if you asked that. But they're really hard to decide. I don't know if that qualifies. Well, the terror mask on the, because I did, God, I feel like if you haven't heard about it, then I don't want to tell you. But because it's a terrible, awful video game. But I played the Terror Mask, and people occasionally will bring up, I guess when they first, you guys ever, Splatterhouse? I guess when they first put the game out originally, you got a really cool mask with it, and it was a matter of thing. And that's an interesting thing to decide. Did that answer your question?
Well, it was interesting to you.
Okay.
So,
okay.
It sounds pretty boring, actually. Not that. Yeah, weird. Oh, jeez. I usually just pass if it's too weird. So I'm just like, no, I'm sorry. Thank you.
Oh, yeah, I did do that once. Some guy brought up, and it was professionally done, and it was like, you know, but it was Winnie the Pooh as the Punisher. From, you know, you guys know the Punisher.
Right? Yeah, the art Disney character.
And he just stood in there, and it was like really well done, and I'm like, I ain't signing this. and he had a gun, and you can imagine what everybody in Hunter Acre would look like. And I go,
No.
So, yeah, there you go. Aww. Thanks for reminding me. You're a sweetheart.
I'm into musical theater also. That's something I really want to get into later on. I was wondering, what's the most magical part of knowing that you are a huge part of children's childhoods, including mine?
Amazing, it's so touching, and we never know. I mean, we speak nonsense in windowless rooms, you know, and we come here, it's wonderful to meet everybody.
Yeah, I think so too. Yeah, we spend our days in padded rooms with padded walls. I guess, because I've been doing it for so long, you know, a lot of grown adults were coming. They'll bring in their kids, and they'll have like a stack of like a Tailspin or Darkwing DVDs, and I'm going, the 7-year-old's dressed as Darkwing Duck or something. I'm like, how does he know? And I go, Dad, I'm raising him right. He's got the DVD. Okay, that's pretty good, you know, and that's really rewarding. It's nice to know because, and you know, I've thought this for a long time too, because when I very started, I did a cartoon and I had like a terrible cold, and I remember seeing it on the internet. Oh man, I should have stayed home. So the one thing that I do, that I have in my mind is that, if you think about it, 1939, they made Snow White, Gone with the Wind, and Wizard of Oz. Yes. And if you released those movies now, they'd be just as timely and competitive as they ever were. And the message in that is that they just live forever. You know, these shows, they live forever. So for me, I treat everyone like it's the Super Bowl or a title, heavyweight title fighter, whatever, you know what I mean? It's like, I got every single time it has to be the best I can be, and so that's part of the reward for me, you know, and then with all the, I got stories that I could make you cry over, from sweet, you know, kids that have been, you know, they would have a handicap or mentally challenged or this and that, and the parents are the ones that, you know, kind of get to you, because they'll tell me, you know, things about, wow, you know, he did this and he was depressed or whatever, and so he had that one song in that world that he played over and over again, and when you hear that, when you realize somebody, you know, got a boost and brought them back up again, that's good stuff.
Yeah, I heard that you actually call some kids in the hospital and your Winnie the Pooh voice out here.
Yeah. Yeah.
Aww. Thank you very much. Aww. Oh wait, I have a question for you. Oh. You got 8 bars?
Could you be in a cube?
Yeah, could you be in a cube? Two best 8 bars. 5, 6, 7.
8 bars of what? Like, what kind of musical? Like,
what have you got?
Oh. Put you on the spot.
Hey, it's okay.
Yeah.
It's okay, you don't have to. I told you, John. When you love poop, when you love poop, when you love poop, when you love
poop. Yeah! Woo! Don't stop. Keep it going. How do you follow that, Josh?
I just gotta follow celebrities because when watching movies, I prefer to watch movies for themselves. But with voice actors, I watch for voice acting because you guys have an exuberant amount of talent that is beyond compare when you just put yourself through sincere acting behind the microphone. And that's just saying. As movie fanatics, sometimes I like noticing people who I did not expect on the credits, like with you, I noticed you in Groundhog Day, and
yes.
I noticed you in a mockumentary film called Concord the Movie, and those were just...
I apologize.
It's okay, I love this, and did you have, like, any memorable experiences working in some live-action projects?
Well... You know, I haven't done very much, but there was a scene in there that never made it to the movie.
What?
Anyway, my guy that I didn't even know who that was. It was Mark Hamill's idea. Just say something. Okay, and go. What? You know, and that was almost, it was almost like that. But there was one of the extra or whatever things was apparently. Was an adult actress, you know?
Oh.
I guess the joke was that my guy from that movie you were talking about ended up getting drunk on absinthe and passed out on a lounge. And this actress said, well, why don't I, while he's passed out, do something? And they were, you know, to be friendly to him. And they were kind of doing it, and I can't, so yeah, that would be the most embarrassing one that you never saw. And I'm glad. There's a reason you never saw it. It wasn't what you're thinking. It's just uncomfortable.
Yeah.
For me, I'm a cornball, I guess.
It's all good, sir.
Okay, thanks.
I was really lucky. I mean, I was headed on a total actor's trajectory when I was younger, and I got to work with some pretty amazing people like Bill Murray and Herb Ramis and Cameron Crowe. And I honestly never really looked on camera. It was like, wait, what? Just stand there, and it's really about my hair. It's really about my hair. And behind a microphone, I just felt like I was home. You know, it's like, okay, I'm limited by nothing. Now, you can play a bird, a little boy, and an old witch, and a superhero in one day. And it's not about me. I mean, that's really nice that you say you follow voice actors, but I mean, I'm so hidden, like right now I'm going, please. I'm so shy. Aww. But for me, it's not supposed to be about me, Kendon. It's supposed to be about Starfire. And that's a collaboration between the writer, the artist, and me, and the director. And what that is what the character becomes. And that's all I ever wanted to be.
Aww.
Yeah, I do relate to the experience of not going to come on camera from taking an on-camera class myself 4 years back. And I've most felt comfortable on stage.
Yeah, and voiceover and stage are really quite similar.
Yeah. It's in the moment, that's for sure.
Yes.
Thank you very much, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, she, Heather, Michael Shannon's girlfriend.
I hope you guys would be very kind and play along with this. I saw a video of you did online where there was a panel of people where you were doing your reading of the script of Star Wars, and they made you do Winnie the Pooh as Darth Vader. And ever since I've seen that, it is like I have a little supervillain poo in my head, and I'm like, mad at us.
You weren't on any mercy mission this time. You are part of the Rebel Alliance,
in the spine. That's crazy, huh?
So I was wondering if you guys would be willing, if we have Supervillain Pooh and Starfire trying to defeat Supervillain Pooh, what would happen? I don't care if you guys voice acted or if you just tell us what would happen. I just want to know.
Can we do it in mime? I have no idea. But if you write it, they will. If you build it, they will.
Yes. Write it, they read. Is that how it goes? Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Then we'll do it.
Okay.
We'll be back here in a year or so.
Yes.
We'll do it. Okay.
Remember, instincts are the best sticks.
Hello. My question is, what tips would you give to anyone pursuing a career in voice acting?
Oh, don't do it. No. I don't know. You know, I always was a sponge. You know, I would do, you know, my Aunt Grace, God rest her soul, and Uncle Sam had been in a lot of cartoons, but they didn't know it. So, what about you? I don't know.
I would tell people.
Yeah, what's the best tip?
I say be an actor. Yeah. Be an actor and get experience being an actor and be the best actor you can possibly be, doing other things, doing everything else. Because I don't think you can't just walk into this.
Yeah.
You gotta
yeah.
have a lot of stuff going on. That's not this.
Yeah, you know, people say, well, you know, a lot of times people say, well, I do great voices, I do this and that. And that's fine. That's good and everything, but the thing is, we're really just character actors, and we do, you know, do you do voices? Well, yeah, but it's mostly you're doing characters, and that's just what they sound like. That's what that character sounds like. You know, that's the way I've always thought about it.
Yeah.
And then, you know, and then when it comes to like making a character or getting a signature sound, I always tell people, I said, if you do a great impression of somebody that nobody knows who the hell it is, you got a character. You know, there's somebody there. And if you do a terrible impression of someone that everybody knows, that's a new character. You know, then you just mix and match. And when it comes to, you know, as far as the instrument itself, but it's got to start ending, like she said, it starts with the acting. You're an actor. You know, be an actor and absorb everything. And do you know if you do impressions of people, do bad? And like my Uncle Sam, like I said, my cousins used to get, because I'll do my Uncle Sam for you. He's been a dragon, he's been an ogre, and I think he's been a few giants.
And anyway, that's just how he told. He made one of those old guys. And that was how he said, how you doing, Jimmy? Yeah, I love this kid.
That's how he talks. So he was a bit of dragon and ogres and stuff.
Like, say,
what the?
Someone named
Pendleton
Moore,
perhaps. Yeah.
Yeah.
So jump on in, the water's fine.
Thank you.
Just one. Hey. Hi. Just to build off the last question, how do you guys show emotion? You guys are doing voices. How do you do what?
Show
emotion. Oh, I never
did. Okay.
I'm sorry.
I just fake it. But it's like, you know, can't you always tell when someone's smiling? When they're saying something, somebody's on the radio or they're going, you know, you can hear it. I don't know. So if it's inside of you, they can tell. Okay, yeah.
All right, I have two questions. One for both of you, and the other one is just going to ask Jim here.
Okay.
had to do with voice. So how do I know my voices sound good? Like the voices of a character. Like, let's say I was playing idiot. How would I know that that voice I'm doing sounds all right?
That's a good question.
Well, I always think that you have to be psychic. If you're flawlessly psychic, then you can get every part you read for.
That's the way to do it.
Yes.
Okay, I am psychic, and I know what you're thinking. How am I psychic? Well, how do I think I know that? Second thing,
not
physics.
Yeah, so I
you know, but geez, I don't know. Well, you know, people laugh, I suppose, right? Mm-hmm. And if you're doing a dramatic scene, they cry. And if you're a bad guy, they supposed to vet you. I gotta believe that'd be a good way to go.
Is it
a
question?
But I mean, if you get a job, that's
another one. That's the
one right there. You know, let's hire him. Well, you did a good job.
Then that was right.
No, you. Yeah, yeah. Didn't you know that was right? My second question. Jim, can you do the voice of Set from Fallout 1? That's like my favorite voice.
Who's that?
Set, the Ghoul King.
Oh, yeah.
Stand in my shadow, Normie.
There, I don't have to.
No. What is your name? My name is Ian Reamer.
Ian Reamer.
Ghoul King.
Oh, that's what I meant. Hi.
Hello.
There you are. We've been waiting for you. Where have you been?
Yes, I'll get on first and go.
Oh, all right.
Okay. So, I was wondering, have anybody done a Tigger song again?
What?
Tigger song again.
Oh, sure. Like now, you mean?
Yeah.
Oh, here. Yeah. I thought you meant if I was ever gonna, probably. The thing about tears is tigers are wonderful things. Their cubs are made of rubber, their bottoms are made of the spring. They're flouncy, clumsy, bouncy, flouncy, bun, 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 bun. But the most wonderful thing about tears is I'm the only one. I'm the only one. So the answer is no. Thank you, sweetie.
Hi.
Hi again, some more for the first time.
I was wondering if you could do a conversation between Princess Imelda and Tigger.
Aww.
Oh.
Hey, Tigger, what you got?
Tigger and Princess Bubblegum.
Yeah.
I have a lot of stuff going on in Ooh today. I need you to do some things.
I'm sorry. I have got a bones.
The famous Broadway song.
Just couldn't fight the feeling. But you're having a good hair day. An excellent hair day.
Yes.
Is this thing?
I have a question for Jim Cummings.
Yes.
Like, if there's a show that you love so much, which, like, back in the 80s or the 90s, like, what show would you want to come back on air and... Or like if there was a character on that set show you want to reprise a role, like a show like Project Geeker, does that sound like
that? That was a great show. Yeah. I really thought that was a good show. I didn't get recognized the book. That's one.
Yeah.
Get that one. How about that one? Not the Garbage Pail Kids movie.
Oh God.
every now and then people. Well, I guess they are bringing back DuckTales, but everybody, I would love to have a Darkwing Duck back.
Oh, yes, man. Please. Please, yes.
It was just a lot of fun, and we did a fake, an April Fool's Day Kickstarter on the HBO's Funny or Die, a year or two ago, and everybody's like, oh, wow, they're going to do that, but it was April Fool's joke. But it wouldn't be if they did it for real.
Cool.
I'd be there.
I know.
Start writing letters or something. I don't know. Oh, how do you do that? I don't know. But yeah, I'm there. If you get it going, I'll promise I'll show up. How about you? What show do you think we should bring back?
How is there a toss up between Darkwing Duck and Project Geeker?
There you go.
Yeah.
I'm there for both of them.
I've
never heard of it. All right, thanks. Billy's downstairs.
Okay, well, quick question. I thought that he's coming up with Princess Bubblegum and Poison Love Kings.
Well, yeah, they get along really well.
Yeah, I think so.
Get off of my property!
That's me, yeah, that's his theme song.
Look at the black box. They're getting bad here.
Hello.
Can everyone hear me okay?
Yes.
No. I was kidding, see, I would have been able to answer if we didn't hear you.
Thank you very much for hanging out with us this weekend. We're really happy that you're here. Both of you have made an impact on a lot of little ones. I work as a preschooler, so I get to hear about all of your roles through them. Could you please share an experience you've had with the young man?
There's a lot more. You know, it's kind of, well, you know, boy, I've had them go both ways. Like a little three-year-old, sometimes they just light up when I'll do like a coo or a kick or something like that. And then I actually had one little one, but this was like a baby. This poor little thing was probably about 10 months old. And for most of it, she just loves putting the poo in. And when we put it on, and she gets so smiley and just so happy and everything. And I, of course, this is the face that produces the sound. So it's like, well, like, she's just as sweet as honey. And the little thing goes, oh. Like, he ate Winnie the Pooh. Winnie the Pooh. This man ate Winnie the Pooh. He's crying from inside this guy. And I'm like, I'm so sorry.
Yeah, very similar experiences. It's either little ones, little tiny ones, they either totally get it or they totally don't get it. And then I will resort to close your eyes or put up that picture of my character in front of me and make it talk. Hello, wonderful friend. Is our Starfire?
Yes. Starfire with her anyway. Isn't that cool? So yeah. How about you? Did you ever have one? Did you ever scare any kids?
I'm angry.
As a preschooler.
I'm sometimes.
You'd make a good 4-year-old. You're a scared. I think I know what you meant. Thank you. Hey, come on down.
All right, so I'm wondering, you know, we're all known for kind of having larger than life characters like Minx, Fuzzy Wumpkins, like you said. Where do you find the energy?
I don't know. Coffee?
Yes.
An overactive imagination.
Caffeine beverages.
I was hyper as a kid. And, God, can we get this kid something to calm him down for crying out loud? I didn't know that there was such a thing as hyperactive and ADD and ADHD. I just thought I was annoying. So, I don't know. I guess it just comes naturally. Where's the energy come from? I don't know. I never thought about it. Now I won't be able to do the things.
I don't know, it just comes out.
Yeah. Where do you get the energy to be this cool? See? Well, that wouldn't work for me. Thank you very much. Glad. Yes, indeed. Oh, man, I thought you were going to get arrested.
Recording. Oh, no, wait, it's recording.
He's like a zombie Nazi dude. He's a leader. Dude, he so just stole your camera. Did anyone notice that? Mr. Smooth is gone.
All right, hello. I'll make this real quick. What accent do you think his voice is?
You do what?
Don Carnage's voice.
Yes.
What? If you were to pick an accent, what accent would you think it is?
Oh, well, you know, I purposely made sure that he didn't have one. Yeah, you can't tell where he's from because I don't think any country would like him. They would say, a lot of times people say he sounded like a Russian from Cuba.
Well, you know, I have to tell you this right now, between the face. If I was not me already, I would envy you getting to meet me.
That's how much I love me. He's a very calm, very self-effacing guy. So I and a little bit of Ricky Ricardo in there, but he sounds French and Russian. And honestly, I think I act. That's a pretty good question because I remember doing like three or four shows in, and Tad Stones and Jimmy Smith, the directors and writers and everything. They're going, well, where's this guy from? And I said, well, I don't think, you know, if we nail down the country that he's from, then we'll be probably ticking off the people from that country. So we made sure that he was kind of anomalous, kind of vague, and you couldn't nail him down. So apparently it worked. Yeah. I'm still asking them questions like 3 years later. Yeah. So cool. Yeah. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. You have a wonderful day.
Get your camera back.
No.
Which is like it's exactly what you just described. There's no way you can figure out where it's from.
Yeah.
And it was a little Russian.
Yeah. Because if we take them off, who cares? They're already mad at us.
Hey, just wanted to say a good fan of you, Ms. Walsh, and I made your Facebook fan page because there wasn't an answer. But my real question is, do you guys have a dream role that you like super want, but never.
I wanted to be Starfire.
No. I mean, dream roles, stuff is being written. You know, so we don't know what it is. I mean, it's being created right now, and sometimes you'll get something and you'll be like, this is awesome. If I'd known about it before, I would have really, really wanted it. Bubblegum was one of the rare ones that I had been a fan of the short, the Frederator short that they did for Adventure Time, the Nickelodeon passed on.
Oh.
Oh my gosh, this is the most brilliant thing I've ever seen in my life. And then I get called into Bubblegum and I'm like, yes, this one. This is the one I want.
Yeah.
But it really happens that way.
I don't know. Well, as far as one that I haven't done, maybe the next one. That'll be my dream role, the next one. But I can tell you that I really, 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 really wanted to be King Louie for Tailspin, because I was nuts about Louis Prima, and I really, really, I just realized I can all sing people. But the California Raisins, I was the lead singer for the California Raisins, and I really, 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 really wanted that one. And then I have to say that Ray for Princess and the Frog was, I really wanted that one. Because I knew that, I would end up hearing those damn songs sung by Harry Connick. It was me and Harry Connick Jr., by the way. We were down to the end of the mall. Crap! He's totally famous. He's gonna get it. You know, because I knew that my little girls were gonna be hearing those. I was gonna hear these, you know, when I've got kids. And I'm gonna be hearing these songs for the next 10 years. And I'm gonna be on it. Dang, got it. That Firefly should have been me. So that one was a dream role. Because I got it, I guess. You know? So, yeah. How about you? Yeah.
I could answer what cosplay I want to be. I've always wanted to be Mulan, but I'm not Asian, so.
Do it!
I kinda, like,
do it! You can still do it!
You can still do it!
Yes, this is true.
Just do it! Yeah. Just do it!
Hi, guys. Hey! So, this is Walsh. I was wondering, like reading the scripts for the original Teen Titans series, was there ever a moment of like pure like badassery where like you read the script and you're like, this is such a cool moment for Starfire. Like, I can't wait to read this. I can't wait for fans to see this. Like, this is gonna be such a cool thing. Was there ever a moment that like pops in your mind that was like that?
When we were doing the show, you mean?
Yeah.
Gosh, I mean every show. David Slack was the head writer of the show, and he's such a talented man. He's in On Camera Land now, bless him. But, I mean, they write us stuff. Okay, the best one that I got was from an episode called Truck, which was Carpate and I got to just fill the room up with pain. And it was really, really fun. Do you
know who doesn't love pain?
If you didn't know it, it was an alien from another culture came and called Starfire a bad name on the planet, which was Tron. And then the other Titans tried to call her that, and she was like, oh, you will not call me that! And Cyborg and Starfire have a moment, and he's like, you mean somebody's judging you just based on where you're from and what you look like? Of course I understand. I'm part robot.
Aww. Yes.
So, yeah,
thank you. Don't ever call her a truck. I think this is our last question. So come on down.
Oh, you're stuck. We have no more. Will you ask us something?
Oh, so you're not going to ask a question?
Oh, okay.
You're fine. No respect, Mr. Spamda. What is that? Spamda?
Yes, Spamda. Oh, okay. It's our specialized
Panda
staff.
Sweet Spam?
Yes. Yeah. My
it is specialized.
I don't have a question. Sorry.
That's okay.
He wants to ask you to do Ray.
He did what?
He wants to ask you to do Ray.
Oh, which means you want to do Ray.
Yes, I am indirectly saying, I don't know what. Who's Ray?
Oh, the frog.
You know, then we have a day like a man with a big back poach. Yeah, you are. Yeah.
Don't make me that back butt.
I'll let you do too. Thanks. Thanks, everybody.
Big guy, the sun's looking mighty low.
Ooh, Hulk happy that he's wearing stretchy pants.
Whoa, Hulk, you wanna play hide the cucumber?